Hello, my name is Keshwani.
That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I,
Keshwani. We're here because we want to prepare for GMAT. We have been solving GMAT math problems out of this book here, the GMAT Official Guide 2022. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. Always make sure that this book is in front of you when you're working with me. Today we'll solve some problems that you will find on page number 135. Page 135 and page 136. The very first problem that we see there on page 135, number 148. Number 148 says that n is equal to 20 factorial plus 17. Given this fact that n is equal to 20 factorial plus 17, the question is n is divisible by which of these three numbers, 15, 17, or 19? Well, let's take a look at it, shall we? 20 factorial, as we know, is made up of 20 times 19 times 16 and so on and so forth. Therefore, if you were to take 17 out of it, you see this thing is multiple of 17. It's 20 times 19 times 18 times 17 and so on and so forth. So this 20 factorials can be written as, we can take the 17 out and it can be written as 16 factorial times 18 times 19 times 20. That's what this is. And of course we have a 17 here. And therefore we can take the 17 common. 17 can be taken out common, and here what we're left with is this quantity, which is 16 factorial plus, not plus rather, times 18 times 19 times 20. So that's this quantity. Plus, we took out the 17 common, so we have a 1 there. The point here is that this quantity, which is the n, as you can clearly see, is a multiple of 17. Since it's a multiple of 17, this quantity is divisible by 17. What happens if we try to divide this quantity by 17? If we try to divide n, or rather by 15, if we try to divide n by 15, this quantity is multiple of 15, because it has 15 in it. But then we have a 17. If we try to do that, n divided by 15 will give us a remainder of 2. Because when we try to divide 17 by 15, we'll have a remainder of 2. So it's not divisible by 2. Similarly, if we try to divide n by 19, this will give us a remainder of actually 17. Because this quantity is divisible by 19, but 17, if you try to divide by 19, it doesn't go into it. We have a remainder of 17. Hence, n is divisible by 17, but not 15 or 19. The answer is 2 only. The answer is 2 only, which is C. Number 149. In number 149, we are told that $1 is equal to 5.3 francs, and which is equal to 1.6 marks. Okay. The fact that France and Germany no longer use francs and marks, now they have euro, that doesn't concern us here. The point here is this. We are told that some guy paid 480 marks, M stands for marks, and he sold some, whatever it is that he bought, he sold it for 2,385 francs. The question is, what is his profit? So he bought something in Germany. He bought something in Germany for 480 marks and he took it to France and he sold it for 2,385. The question is, what is his profit in dollars? That's what we're interested in. And here the answer choice is 0, 50, 100, 150, and 200. So what we need to realize here is that since we are looking for a profit, these quantities represent profit. So if the answer happens to be zero, that means he made no profit. In other words, he sold it for the same amount of money that he bought it for. Let's see how much he paid for it in dollars. We know that he paid 480 marks, and we know that 16 marks makes $10, because 1.6 marks is $1. Multiply both sides by 10, and we find that 160 marks is equal to $100. Well, he did not pay 160 marks, he paid 480. And these numbers are there for a reason. You have to make the connection right away. You clearly see that 16 times 3 is 480. In other words, he paid $300 for it. The question is, did he make a zero profit? Well, that's very easy to find out. If he sold the thing for the same amount of money that he bought it for, that means that he sold it for $300. And we know that $100, let's do it here. We know that $100, because of the fact that it's five point three francs, well, 5.3 times 100, which is 530 francs. We know that $100 is equal to 530 francs. I'm going to make it very quick. If he had in fact made a zero profit, this quantity would have been 300. And we clearly see 500 times 3 is only 1500. He did not sell it for 1500 francs. He sold it for much more than that. He sold it for more than 2000. He did not even make a profit of 100. Had he made a profit for 100, he would have sold it for $400. 500 times 4 is 2000. He sold it for 2385. Let's see if he made $200 profit. If he indeed made a $200 profit, he would have sold it for $500. 500 times 530 is more than 2500. He sold it for only 2350. The answer is 150. And if you want to confirm it, you can very easily do that. Let's first do, since this represents a profit of 150, which means he must have sold it for 450. He bought it for $300. He sold it for 450, hence making a profit of 150. And we can very easily verify this thing. Multiply that by 4. And that gives us 0, 2, 20 plus 1 is 21. So that's this, unless I made a mistake. 0, 12, 2, carry 1, that's right. So that represents $400. This represents $400. As you can see, this is less than this amount. We need to add 50 more dollars. And we know $100 is equal to 530 francs. Half of 530, half of 500 is 250, half of 30 is 15. So half of 530 should be 250 plus 15, which is 265. And what do you suppose we're going to get when we add 265 to it? We should get this quantity. 5, 8, 3, and 2. There you go. He sold it for 2,385 francs, which represents $450. But as you can see, we really don't have to do any of this work. We have to be quick enough to realize that he could not have possibly made a zero profit. Zero profit means that he sold it for $300. Well, 530 times 3, I'm repeating myself, is only 1500. He definitely did not sell it for $400, because 500 times 4 would have been 2000, as you can see, around 2000. And he clearly did not sell it for made a profit of $200, because that would mean 530 times 5 would be more than 2500. Therefore, the answer has to be 150. In 150, we are given two maps. We are given map K. In map K, we are told that 1 inch represents 20 miles. On map K, 1 inch represents 20 miles. And I'm just going to use letter M for miles. And if you think of this as meter, it makes no difference at all. And here's the other map, map L. Map L, 1 inch represents 30 meters. As you can see, the scale here is much bigger. The question here is that if you have the area of 3 square inches on this map and 3 square inches on this map, because the scale is much larger, the question is, the area of 3 square inches represents how many more meters, how many more square meters here than it does here. That's what it is. 3 square inches is simply 3 inch times 1 inch, of course. That's why it's called 3 square inch. 3 inch, since 1 inch is equal to 20 meters, this represents 60 meters, this represents 20 meters, so that was very easy. 6 times 2 is 12, so it's 1200 square meters. Let's see what the 3 square inches represents here. 3 square inches, again, is same as 1 inch times 3 inch. 1 inch here is 30 meters, and 3 would be 90 meters. 3 times 9 is 27, so it's 2700 square meters. There you go. So the answer simply is 27 minus 12 is 1500 square meters more. The map, that an area of 3 square inches represents 1500 more square inches on this map than it does on this map? The answer is E. Number 151. In 151, we have two negative integers. It's important that we understand that they are negatives, and they are calling them lesser and greater. That's what they're calling them. That's what we're going to call them. We're going to use letter L to represent the lesser. We're going to use letter G to represent the greater one. The first thing we are told is that their product is equal to 160. The product of the lesser integer and the greater integer, we are told, is 160. That's the first equation. Of course, we have to have two equations because we have two unknown. The second equation, we are told that the lesser one, the lesser integer, we are told, is 4 less than twice the greater. 4 less than twice the greater. So now all we have to do is convert this sentence into a mathematical sentence. A sentence in mathematics is an equation. Lesser is, which means equal, 4 less than what? 4 less than twice the greater. Twice the greater, but lesser does not equal twice the greater. That actually obviously makes no sense. 4 less than that. There you go. There is our second equation. And the question simply is, what we're trying to figure out is, what is the greater one? Two very straightforward equations, two unknown, we can solve for it. We know that lesser is this one, 2g minus 4. Let's put it in here. Let's put it in this one. So L times G, and we know L is this quantity, 2G minus 4. So 2G minus 4, that's our L, times G equals 160. If you open the parentheses, we find that well, actually, before we open the parentheses, I see this is 2 and this is 4. Why don't we take out the 2 common here? And we end up with g minus 2, because we're taking out 2 common. G minus 2 times g is equal to 160. Divide both sides by 2, and that's it. So what we end up with here, I'm going to pick up the story on this side. What we end up here is this equation. G minus 2 times G is equal to 80. Now at this stage, at this point, we have to make a decision. We can continue this with this question in a very classical way, very traditional way, very algebraic way, by converting it into a quadratic equation. Not by converting it, it already is. If you multiply it out, you're going to end up with G squared minus 2G minus 80 is equal to 0, and you can solve this quadratic equation if you wanted to. I'm not going to do it that way, because it's not necessary. It's not necessary because it's a very straightforward situation. This thing and this thing, this is 2 more than that. If you think of it, if you have 10 times 8, it will give us 80. There you go. But because we're dealing with two negative numbers, since we're dealing with two negative numbers, they're negative quantities. G, of course, is negative. There you go. Only thing that we have to realize is that this quantity, which represents the G minus 2, G is in fact negative 8, and G minus 2 is negative 10. I think that's about it. We are done. G is negative 8. We are done. If you wanted to verify it very quickly, here's our 0, here's our greater one, here's our lesser one. Let's find out what it is. I'm going to quickly verify it. We're going to take a few seconds to verify it. I wouldn't do it in a real exam, but we're going to do it here. G is negative 8. The lesser we are told, right here, is 2 times g minus 4, 2 times g. If g is negative 8, 2 times negative 8 is going to be negative 16. Negative 16 minus 4 is going to be negative 20. There you go. This is your 20. And does negative 20 times negative 8 equal positive 160? Of course it does. Where is it? Right here. Of course it does. It confirms. The greater of the two integers is negative 8, and the lesser one is negative 20. Which is why, hence this weird equation, lesser is only 4 less than twice the greater. In In 152, we are told that the depth of a well is given by negative 20 times T minus 5 squared plus 500. And we are told that this equation gives us the depth of the well T hours past 2 a.m. That's very important to understand. This relationship, n represents the depth of the well, and n is equal to this quantity at T hours past 2 o'clock in the morning. The question is, at what time is the depth maximum? At what time is the maximum depth? We're looking for maximum depth, which is n here. Actually, we're not looking for maximum depth, we're looking for what time. At what time is the depth maximum? What we have to understand here is that this is negative 20. Negative 20, that means this is a negative quantity. T minus 5 squared, because it's being squared, it doesn't matter, even if this quantity happens to be negative, since it's being squared, this is positive, which means this entire quantity is negative. Which means that every time we put some value for 2 here, we're taking something away from 500. The only time we're not going to take anything away from 500 is when this quantity is equal to 0. If this quantity that you see here is 0, that will be the maximum depth. Because anything other than that will always take out, will always take away something from it. Because this is positive, this is negative 20. Negative 20 is some positive quantity, it's going to be negative. So the question is, when is this quantity 0? This quantity, negative 20 T minus 5 squared, is 0 when T is equal to 5. If T is equal to 5, 5 minus 5 will give us 0, and 0 times negative 20 will give us 0. If this quantity is 0, depth is 500 meter, it is the maximum depth. After that, the depth begins to go down. The depth is 500, but at what time? Well, at 5 hours past 2 a.m. It is at maximum at 5 hours past 2 a.m. Well, if it's 5 hours past 2 a.m., the depth must be maximum. Depth is maximum at 7 in the morning. The depth of the well is maximum at 7 in the morning. 5 hours past 2 a.m. That was number 152. Let's keep on moving. We are at 153. Is a very straightforward question. Here's what is told to us. We are told that we are dealing with a square, we are told, and the sides are measured. To the nearest centimeter. And if you do that, that side equals to 6 centimeters. But it's a whole number. It is measured to the nearest centimeter. The question is, what is the least possible value for the area? What is the least possible area of the square such that when you measure the size of this square to the nearest centimeter, it is 6 centimeters? Well, if that's the case, if you're going to measure to the nearest centimeter, and since you want the smallest it can be is 5.5 centimeters. Because had it been more than 5.5, had it been 5.51, you would have rounded it up to 6 centimeter. So the smallest is 5.5. Had it been 5.49, you would have rounded it to 5 centimeter. You get the idea. So the smallest side it can be have, and still when rounded to near a centimeter, well, it should be meter actually. Let's just leave the units out. Oh, there it was, meter. Do you understand? That's what it is. So all we have to figure, this is the smallest possible length of the sides, 5.5 meters, because when you round it to the nearest meter, it becomes 6 meters. Therefore, Since these are the smallest size, therefore the least possible area is simply 5.5 times 5.5. 5 times 5 is 25. Half of 5 is 2.5. Half of 5 is 2.5 again. And half of half is 1/4. There you go. 2.5 and 2.5, that's a 5. 5 plus 25 is 30. 30 plus 1/4 is 30 1/4. 30 1/4 unit squared. Whatever the unit happens to be. Units are of no interest to us. Do you understand? Whether it's square meter or square inches or square centimeter makes absolutely no difference as far as we are concerned. The answer is 30 1/4. 154, the very last problem on this page. In this 154, what is going on here is that we are told that we have already run 3.5 miles. And again, I'm going to use M for miles. Whether you think of that as a meter makes no difference. We have run already 3.5 miles. We'll run for another 50 minutes at 8 minutes per mile. That is our speed. That's the speed we're going to run at. We're going to take 8 minutes for every mile, and we're going to do so for 50 minutes. And the question is, how far can I go from this point on? Because I've already run 3 1/4 miles. You see, this is a starting point. Let's call it point S for the starting point. I've already run 3.5 miles. I'm going to run for another X miles. And then come back, obviously come back. We have to come back to the starting point. And I'm going to do all of that for 50 minutes. The question simply is, how far out can I go and still be able to come back to the starting point in 50 minutes? In other words, we have to cover the distance of x plus 3 1/4. That's the distance we have to cover. This distance, and this distance in 50 minutes. In order for us to figure out how many miles can be run beyond 3 1/4 miles that we have already run, the very first thing we have to figure out is how many miles can I go in 50 minutes. Let's find out, shall we? Again, it's very straightforward. We know the speed. I'm going to do it a couple of different ways. And since I'm going to do it a couple of different ways, it will make more sense to have a nice juxtaposition. One way is this thing right here. 8 minutes. For 1 mile. It's very straightforward. 8 minutes for 1 mile. If we multiply that by 6, it tells us that we're going to take 48 minutes for 6 miles. Obviously, because we multiply both sides by 6. We're not running for 48 minutes. We are told to run for 50 minutes. We have to run another 2 minutes. Well, how far can we go in 2 minutes? Well, if you're taking 8 minutes for 1 mile, you're going to take 4 minutes for half a mile. In 2 minutes, you're going to go 1/4 mile. So if you go for another 2 minutes, you're going to go 1/4 mile. And there you go. 50 minutes will take us 6 1/4 miles. In other words, the total distance that we cover is to 6 1/4 miles. That's one way of doing it. Another way is to set it up as a proportion problem. Very straightforward. Here's the minutes, and here's the miles. And our speed is 8 minutes for 1 mile. The question is, how far can I go in 50 minutes? So for x, that's all. X is equal to 50 over 8, which is same as 25 over 4, and 25 over 4, 24 over 4 would be 6, 25 over 4 would be 6 1/4. Same as this one, obviously. The rest is very straightforward. I need the room, so I'm going to raise the top now. So remember, this distance that we have to travel, plus all of this distance coming back, not this part, this part we already covered. So we have to have x plus 3 1/4 has to equal 6 1/4. It becomes actually so simple that we don't have to actually do it out on a blackboard. We can even do it mentally. X plus x is 6x. 6 1/4 minus 3 1/4 is going to give us 3. If 2x equals 3x, is a mile and a half. X equals mile and a half. Just do it on the top if you like. Not necessary, because it's very simple. So the distance of x plus 3 1/4 has to equal 6 1/4. Therefore, 2x equals 3 and x equals 1 1/2. In other words, if you're going to walk, if you're going to run at the speed of, if you're going to take 8 minutes for every mile, if you're going to run at that speed, and if you only have 50 more minutes to run, the farthest that you can go for another 1 1/2 miles, that's all. Because you want to be able to come back on the starting point in 50 minutes. We are on the next page, 155. In 155, we are told that we're going to deposit money. We're going to deposit X dollars. This is the time. This is the time, and we're going to deposit X dollars. That's our starting point. At the end of 1 year, it's going to grow by 8%. We're going to earn 8%. It's going to grow by 8%. What is going to grow by 8%? Our X dollars, because we're depositing X dollars into account. If it's going to grow by 8%, it's going to become 1.08x. So that's how much money we have in the account right now at the end of first year. In addition to that, at the end of the first year, not only we have this amount, but we're going to deposit another X dollar. Another X dollars. So this is a new deposit. Let's see how much we'll have at the end of 2 years. At the end of 2 years, this 1.0x is going to grow by another 8%. So this amount becomes 1.08 squared plus x, or not plus x, rather times x. Because this amount becomes 1.08x times 1.08, which is same as 1.08 squared times x. And this amount that we deposited, x dollars, it's going to become 1.08x. There you go. And they're calling this final amount that we have in the account, they're calling it w. The question simply is, what is x in terms of w? Well, the w is simply, let's take out the x common because we want to find the x in terms of w. So it's 1.08 squared, this quantity, plus 1.08. There you go. And since we want x in terms of w, we have to divide w by this quantity. That's all it is. And x is going to be w divided by all of this. 1.08 squared plus 1.08. And we hope and pray to God that one of the answers is going to match that answer, what we have on the blackboard, and it does. The answer is D. Number 156. Number 156, we are told that we are going to have the sum of reciprocal from 201 to 300, and we're going to call it M. M represents Not the integers themselves from 201 to 300, but rather their reciprocal. In other words, the first one is going to be 1 over 201. The next one is going to be 1 over 201, because we're starting with 201. The next one is going to be 1 over 202. The next one is going to be 1 over 203, and so on and so forth, all the way up to 1 over 299 plus 1 over 300. So M represents the sum of the reciprocal of the integers from 201 to 300. The question simply is, what's the approximate range for this M? We're looking for not the precise value, obviously, approximate range for M, for the value of M. Why the approximate range? Let's see how they phrase it actually. It says which of the following is true? Well, if you look at the answer choices, they're just giving you the range for the M. So since we're looking for approximate range, that's what we're going to do. So if you're looking for the two extreme situation, we can pretend that every one of them is 200. So if we pretend that every one of them is 200, it's going to become 1 over 200 plus 1 over 200 plus 1 over 200 all the way up to 1 over 200 plus 1 over 200, 100 of them. 100 of them, because 201 to 300, there are 100 of them. And if you add them all up, this is going to become 100 times 1 over 200. And of course, that's just half. So that's one extreme. The lowest value that n can take is half. Similarly, the highest value it can take is if we pretend that every one of them is 1 over 300. It's 1 over 300 plus 1 over 300 plus 1 over 300. You're going to have 100 of them. So the highest value that m can have is 100 times 1 over 300. Because here we're pretending that every one of them is 300. There you go. It goes away and becomes 1/3. So the range for the m is it can go anywhere from 1/3 to 1/2. There we go. And that is answer choice A. Let's go to 157. Let's see what it has to say. I need the room for 157. 157 says that we have two people, A and B. And we are told that A and B, when they're working together, A and B can do a job in X hours. We are further told that if A were to work alone, by himself, alone, he takes Y hour to do the same job. I'm not going to write it. Obviously, it's understood that we're doing the exact same job. So if Y were to work alone by himself, he takes, rather, if A were to take alone by work alone by himself, he's going to take Y hour. If they work together, they take X hours. The question simply is, how long does B take? Again, I'm not going to write everything down. It's understood. The question here is, how long does B take to do the exact same job when he's working by himself? Let's begin, shall we? I shouldn't have taken up so much room. Since it's already set up, so one more time, working together, they take X hours. A alone takes Y hours. How long does B take? That's the setup. I want to erase this thing so that I have more room on the blackboard so we can keep them separate here. So here's our Mr. A, and here's our Mr. B. We'll look at A first, obviously. So A, we are told that Y hour, he takes Y hour for one job. If he takes Y hour for one job, that implies that in 1 hour, he must do 1 hour Y job. Obviously, it makes sense. Because if he takes 3 hours to do the job, in 1 hour, he will do 1/3 of the job. If it takes 2 hours to do a job, in 1 hour it will do half the job. You get the idea. But he's not working 1 hour. He's not working 1 hour. When they're working together, he's working X hours. We can continue here. We don't have to keep rewriting it. He's not working 1 hour. He's working X hours. So let's multiply both sides by X. There you go. In other words, in X hours, he will do X over Y. X over Y. Job. If he does X over Y job, that implies, if that's the case, we're going to pick up the story here. If that's how much that's how much work he does in X hours, he does X over Y job, that must imply that B must do the remaining 1 minus X over Y, because he does X over Y, so it's 1 minus X over Y job in X hour, because we are told that in X hour they can finish the job. And we do the same thing again. So here I'm going to first write them together. Here it becomes Y minus X. I'm going to take the common denominator. So Y minus X over Y job in X hour. That's how much he does. That's how much job he does. That's how much job he does in X hours. But we don't want him to do. We don't want him to do y minus x over y job. We want him to do the entire job. We want him to do one job. So how do we convert this into one? It's very straightforward. I'm going to erase this demarcation. Let's continue here. It's very straightforward. Multiply both sides by the reciprocal. y over y minus x. If you're going to multiply this side by this quantity, we have to do the same thing here. Y over y minus x. There we go. Now, y over y minus x times y over y minus x over y, when you multiply them together, there we go. We have one whole job. We must do the whole job in this many hours. So x times this quantity. X times this quantity is x times y over y minus x. Well, he can do the entire job in this many hours. That was 157. We have one more to go. I'm going to take a quick break, even though we have only last question, but I just realized that my tea has been getting cold. Blasted, it was already lukewarm. Number 158. 158, we are told that we have two baskets. Let's call them basket A, basket 1, and basket 2. And they both consist of red balls and blue balls. They both have red balls and blue balls. We are told the first basket has 4 red balls. Second basket and 2 blue balls, and the second basket we are told has 3 red balls and 5 blue balls. Question is, we're going to pick one at random, and of course this part shouldn't have to be said. It's understood obviously that it's picked at random. Pick one ball at random from each basket. The question is, what are the odds? What are the odds that you're going to pick one red and one blue? What are the odds? What's the probability that we're going to end up picking one red ball and one blue ball? Do you understand? Again, what we need to understand here is that we are not told pick one red and then one blue from the other one. That's not the case here. They're not asking what are the odds of picking a red one here and what are the odds of picking the blue one here. That's not what they're asking. They're asking what are the odds of picking one red ball and one blue ball if I were to pick one ball from each of these two baskets. Which means there are two possible scenarios. One possible scenario is that pick red and then blue. Pick red from the first basket and blue from the second basket. Or pick blue and then red. In other words, pick blue from the first basket and red from the second basket. And you just find out the odds of those two and just add them up because of the or. It's addition. Because whether we pick red, blue or blue or red, it doesn't matter. The order does not make difference here. They're not looking for the particular order. They're just looking for what are the odds of picking one red ball and one blue ball. Let's see what are the odds of picking a red ball from here. Odds of picking a red ball from the first basket, there are 4 red balls, so it's 4 out of, there are 6 balls altogether, 4 and 2. And then once we have picked a red ball, then we're going to pick the blue ball. Blue balls from this basket, you understand? It has 3 red balls and 5 blue balls, so the odds of picking a blue one from the second basket, this is second basket, is 5 out of 8. Or, we can do the other way around. We can pick a blue one from the first basket here. It has 2 blue balls out of 6. And just like before, I'm going to draw a little arrow. So this blue ball that we're picking here is from this basket, you understand? And then the red one is going to come from this basket. It has three red balls out of eight. There you go. That's all it is. The denominator is the same, 6 times 8, so we don't have to worry about it. 4 times 5 is 20, so it's 20 plus 2 times 3 is 6 over 48. We end up with 26 over 48, which is same as 13 over 24 is our answer. The odds are a little over 50% that we're going to end up, if you were to pick two balls at random, one from each basket, the odds are 50% that we will have, in fact, one of each color. That was the end of that page, 158. We're going to stop right here. Seems logical. We'll meet again tomorrow, obviously. We're going to pick up from where we left off. In the meantime, if you wish to get hold of me, if you would like to work with me, if you would like me to help you with the math portion of the GMAT, you can always reach me by simply sending me an email. Go to my website at keshwaniprep.com, and from there you can send me an email, or you can fill out a form over there on the website if you wish to tell me a little bit more about yourself. I will talk some more. I'll get hold of you. All right? Bye now.